Hello everybody and welcome on the lecture from Introduction to Theoretical Computer Science. Today we will start with a new big topic which is so-called theory of formal languages and theory of automata. This part of theoretical computer science deals with the study of syntax, of syntactic objects. As a typical examples of formal languages, we can imagine things like syntax of programming languages, syntax of different kinds of expressions. We have already seen formally defined syntax of formulas of propositional and predicate logic and so on. So let's start with some basic notions, which are alphabet, word and language. I would like to emphasize that these three notions have, in theory of formal languages, they have slightly different meaning than in a natural language and what's the usual meaning. Here these notions are kinds of mathematical objects, precisely defined mathematical objects with precise meaning that can be viewed as an abstraction or of these informally defined things like alphabet, word and language. Yeah? So in the theory of formal languages, by alphabet we understand arbitrary set of symbols which is typically finite. Yeah? As a typical examples, we can consider the set of all uppercase letters of Latin alphabet, these 26 letters A, B, C, D and so on. Yeah, we can give some name to the alphabet. We will often use Greek letter sigma for this purpose. Yeah, so this alphabet sigma consists of this set of 26 letters. We typically do not assume nothing special about these alphabets. The only important thing that we require is that we should be able to distinguish for two symbols the cases whether the given symbols are the same or whether they are different. Yeah. When we have some alphabet, we can create words over this alphabet. And by a word, we understand arbitrary finite sequence of symbols or letters from the given alphabet. Yeah, so something like this is an example of a word. If I take sequence consisting of H, E, L, L, O, this is an example of a word over a given alphabet. What is important that this is a sequence, so the particular order of symbols in this sequence is important. If I would take sequence consisting, for example, of L, E, L, H, O, it would be some other sequence. It would be a different word, and each symbol can be used arbitrary number of times. Yeah, so here are two other examples of words over the given alphabet. In fact, this is something probably all of you know from different programming languages, because almost every programming language has some data structure for representing strings, yeah, as a sequences of characters. So these mathematical notions of alphabet and word, like defined here in theory of formal languages, can be viewed as abstraction of these things. Let's take some other examples of alphabets and words over these alphabets. Yeah? So, in this second example, let's consider some different alphabets denoted here sigma 2 that will contain 26 letters, uppercase letters from Latin alphabet, and a special symbol representing a space. Yeah, and then now we can create a word like this. Yeah, this word consisting of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 11 symbols. So this whole sequence is viewed as a single word. It's not viewed as a pair of words, but just a single word. Yeah, because this symbol for space does not have any special meaning here. As another example, we can take, it's not necessary that the symbols of alphabet, it's not necessary that they should be letters, yeah? They could be any kinds of symbols. So we can take alphabet consisting of digits, like 0, 1, 2, and so on, up to 9. So now, the sequences of digits can be viewed as a word over this alphabet. Yeah, so this is one example of word, another example of a word. We can take alphabet consisting of symbols 0 and 1. Yeah, so then words over these alphabets are some sequences of zeros and ones, sequences of bits. And this kind of alphabet is in fact quite important, because on the low level, on hardware, basically computers work with words over this alphabet, or what is stored in memory of computers, what is processed by microprocessors, what is stored on disks. All these things are just sequences of zeros and ones. Any kind of data is encoded as a sequence of zeros and ones. So in this sense, this alphabet is quite important. of course, when we want to describe some language in practice, we usually consider those languages that they are somehow reasonable. Yeah? So also the alphabets are something that could be possibly typically chosen as something that could be used for description of something. But when we will do some, when we will study the theory of formal languages itself, to keep the examples small and simple, it's often quite useful to consider very small alphabets, yeah, containing, for example, just two symbols like AB, and consider some completely artificial words, like here the sequences like AA, BA, BB. Yeah. It does not have any special meaning, but we will often use things like that in examples. As a more practical example, what we typically have in mind when we consider different applications of the results of this theory of formal languages, could be something like this. Let's say we would like to describe syntax of some programming language. Programs in the given language can be viewed as a words over alphabet consisting of some character set like ASCII, for example, or Unicode, or some other kind of encoding of characters. And of course, that programmers that when they work in editor on some integrated development environment, so a programmer sees program in a two-dimensional way with rows and lines. But from the formal point of view, and also the way how the programs are in fact stored in memory and or disk, are just a sequence of characters when we have some special symbols for spaces, for ends of lines, and so on. Yeah? So in this sense, the whole program, in our terminology, is viewed as just one single very long word. Yeah? So I do not have enough space on this slide to write the whole word corresponding to this program. But it will be a sequence of these symbols. Now we come to another important notion, which is what we mean by language here in the theory of formal languages. Language in general is defined as some arbitrary sets of words over the given alphabet. Yeah, so in this sense, some programming language like C, Java, Python, or something is the set of all sequences of symbols which are well-formed programs in the given programming language. Nothing else is important here. Yeah? So as I said, theory of formal languages studies syntax. So it does not assign any meaning, any semantics to these sequences of symbols. It's only important which sequence of symbols is well formed and which is not, which belongs to the language and which does not belong to the language. One of the primary motivations of study of things like that comes from constructions of compilers. In fact, not compilers as a whole, but rather some initial parts of compilation process. When we we start with a sequence of symbols like this, and we would like to transform it into more structured form that it would be more suited for translation to possibly to some bytecode or machine code and so on. So these initial phases of compilation are often divided into two separate parts. It's quite common to divide it into two parts. One of them is called lexical analysis and another syntactic analysis. And by lexical analysis, we mean the transformation of sequence of symbols into sequence of so-called lexical elements or tokens, where typical examples of lexical elements are things like keywords, identifiers, separators, operators, integer constants, string constants, comments, and so on. Yeah? So the goal is to recognize things like that and transform this sequence of symbols like C, L, A, S, S, space, age, and so on. And so for example, we determine that this is a keyword, that this is an identifier, this is a left parenthesis, and so on. So this is what's called lexical analysis. And syntactic analysis then takes this sequence of these tokens and tries to find some structure in them. Try to determine, for example, then in a code of a program, something is a declaration of some type, something is a definition of a function or method, to determine that something is a header of a function or method, that something is a name of a method, and something is a type of return value, something is a list of arguments of the method, and there is a body of the method consisting of some statements and which are organized and structured in some particular way, and inside these statements we have some expressions which are evaluated and they have some structure and so on. So recognition of things like that, and there could be errors like, for example, some left parenthesis is not matched with the corresponding right parenthesis and so on. So this is called syntactic analysis, where often the result of such analysis are objects like some abstract syntax tree representing the structure of a program. These things like lexical analysis and syntactic analysis are not used only in compilers for programming languages. They can be useful also for parsing things like some configuration files, some data files which are written in some text format which is structured. Sorry. And so this is one of motivations, and another motivation could be, for example, in the design of algorithms for searching in text. When we have some long text and some pattern that we want to find inside this text, this is again something everybody knows from text editors and web browsers and any kind of programs that processes text, that where we can try to find all occurrences of a given string in some long text. And this search text could be given either explicitly or using some more complicated way, like using a regular expression or some kinds of conditions it should satisfy, and so on. Yeah, so many of these efficient algorithms which are used for searching in text are based on results from formal language theory. So let's go now to the question of how we can specify or describe some formal languages. So in a case when the language is finite, if it contains only a finite number of words, and if this number of words is small, this is not a big problem. We can just list the words, yeah? Like here, if I would have a language containing these three words, so I can just list them and that's all. Yeah. But probably such languages are not so interesting. So what we are more interested in practice, or when we want to describe things like syntax of some programming language like C or Python or Java, is that in this case the language is infinite. It contains infinite number of words, or at least some very big number of words belong to the given language. Eh? Even if we put some restriction on the maximal length of the program, it then would not be infinite. There would not be infinite number of words, but still it would be astronomically big. So it's clear that it's not possible to describe all the syntax of a given programming language by listing all well-formed programs, yeah. So this is not something that would be manageable. So we need some other approach. So we need somehow to specify some property of words that belong to the given language. We can describe it maybe informally in a natural language or using some formalism. Here is an example of such informal description of some very, very extremely simple language. We would have alphabet 0 and 1, and we would say we have a language containing exactly those words that contain even numbers of occurrences of symbol 1. Yeah, so those sequences of zeros and ones that would contain even numbers would belong to the language, and those sequences that would contain odd numbers would not belong to the language. Of course, we could formalize something like this using a predicate logic or possibly some other formalisms, but the problems with such description is that it's rather difficult to work with them, to perform some algorithm or on this description, or to determine whether it has some properties, or to give some proofs of some properties of this language and so on. Yeah? So. Typically, in the theory of formal languages, we use one of two following approaches, which can be viewed as a special case of this general approach when we try to describe some property of words that belong to the given language. The first approach is based on so-called automata. And these automata are some kinds of idealized machines or devices, or maybe and algorithms, yeah. So something that performs some machine that performs some kinds of steps. It obtains some arbitrary word over the given alphabet as an input, and then according to its instructions, it performs some kinds of steps, some kind of computation. And after performing this computation, some number of steps, it will possibly halt and then give an answer, yes or no, that says whether the given word belongs to the language or not. Yeah, so typically the description of such machine is finite. It has only a finite number of instructions, but it's able to process arbitrary words. And it said that the given language described by the given automaton consists of exactly those words for which the automaton gives answer yes, it belongs to the language. This is one possible approach. Another possible approach is based on so-called grammars. Idea is now slightly different. The idea is that we have a finite set of rules that somehow say how to produce words that belong to the given language. Yeah? So we have a finite set of rules that allow to produce more and more words, possibly infinite number of words that could be generated by these rules. A slightly different approach which is exemplified by so-called regular expression is to try to describe the language as a result of performing some operations of some simpler languages. Yeah? So the language is built by some operations from some simpler languages by combining them somehow. So these are the basic kinds of approaches that are typically used for description of languages in theory of formal languages. As we will see, there are many different kinds of automata and many different kinds of grammars. We will discuss only some of them. Yeah, there is quite rich theory concerning both automata and grammars. And we will later see examples of both automata, grammars, regular expression and all these things. So let's go now to some technical notions and mathematical notations, the notation that we will often use in these discussions. Yeah. So at first, if we have an alphabet, so which is typically finite, yeah, like alphabet of consisting of symbols A, B, C, D, and so on. The set of words over these alphabets is denoted by sigma star. Yeah, so this set is infinite, assuming that this alphabet is non-empty. So we can create words over these alphabets which can be arbitrarily long. They must be finite, but there is infinite number of these words. Yeah, so this is the set of all words over the given alphabet. Another quite intuitive notion is the length of the word, which is just the number of symbols in the given string in the given word. Yeah, like this, if AAB has a length 5, because there are 5 symbols. We will use this notation to denote the length of the word, yeah, this vertical bars. And here this W is not a word consisting of symbol W, but it's rather a variable W. It's like in arithmetic, if I would say I have a variable X whose value is 10. So here I have variable W whose value is a string or word consisting of symbols A, B, A, A, B. So the length of this where which is assigned to the given variable is 5. Yeah? So this is what we mean by this notation. It's also sometimes useful to have a notation for representing the number of occurrences of particular symbol. Yeah? So we will use again the vertical bars, but now with our index with a given symbol. So number of occurrences of A in where W is denoted like this. So we have 2 A's. So number of occurrences of A is 2. And number of B's, 3. Yeah? We have 3 B's. I have not emphasized it before, but when I said that a word is some arbitrary sequence of symbols, it includes also the possibility that this sequence could be empty. It can have zero symbols. Such word is called empty word. Yeah. So, like in some programming language, you would typically write a string AB, AAB by using quotes. Yeah. You would write quotes AB, AAB. And quotes, and if you would write just quotes and quotes and nothing in between, so it would mean there are no elements between no symbols between them. So such string or such word is called empty word. It has length 0, and in the mathematical notation we will use this symbol epsilon to denote this empty word. Yeah, this is a Greek letter called epsilon. And this is one of common notations used for this empty word or empty sequence. It's quite similar, like it's a kind of constant. Yeah. So this symbol. So if we write epsilon, it's not a word containing symbol epsilon, but rather this empty word, like constant. Like for example, in mathematics, we have constant pi or constant e to denote Rudolph's number or Euler's number and so on. Yeah. So the epsilon is the only word of length 0. And we can do many different operations with words. And probably the most basic operations we can do with them is the operation of concatenation. We can concatenate words. So what we mean by concatenation? If I take one word like CABC and second word BBA, by concatenating we mean we write the first word and immediately after it the second word. And by this we obtain bigger word like CABC, BBA. Yeah, so this way we have put these two words together and obtain as a result this word CABC, BBA. This is a kind of operation on words, a binary operation on words, which will be denoted by dot, like multiplication in arithmetic. Yeah? So if dot is applied on numbers, it means multiplication, but here it means concatenation of words. And like multiplication, this dot for multiplication is often omitted, so it's the same case with concatenation. Yeah? So if U and V are some words, so variables, whose values are words over some given alphabet sigma. So concatenation of these two words could be written either like u dot v or just uv, where by this we mean that there is implicitly this dot between them. Yeah, so if value of u is CABC and value of v is BBA, what we have this example we had here, so their concatenation, the result of their concatenation is this, their concatenation is this word. So formally this operation dot, this concatenation, can be viewed as a binary function that takes two words and produces a word over the given alphabet. This operation has some obvious properties. So the first observation is that it's associative. Yeah, so if I take one word and concatenate with some second word and concatenate the result of this with some third word, the result will be exactly the same as if I would take the first word and concatenate it with the result of concatenation of the second and the third word. It follows from this property that whenever I would have some arbitrary number of words and would concatenate them in some particular way, yeah, if I would put parentheses here in some particular way, so if I would put these parentheses in some other way, the result would be exactly the same. Yeah. So for this reason, we can use the convention that we can omit this parenthesis because it's not important the particular way how such expression is parenthesized. We can also note that epsilon behaves as a neutral element with respect to concatenation. Yeah. So like number one is a neutral element with respect to multiplication. If I multiply by one, I will obtain the same number. So if we concatenate word epsilon from left or from right to some given word w, so we will obtain this w as a result. I suppose it's quite obvious that if I add nothing, no symbols to the left or no symbols to the right, the word remains the same. And it's also quite obvious that this operation is in general not commutative, because if I concatenate, for example, A with B, so word A with word B, so the result is word AB, but by concatenating B and A, we obtain BA. So AB and BA are obviously two different words. The only exception is the very special case when we would have alphabet that would contain just one symbol. Yeah, so if I would have alphabet containing just one symbol A and nothing else, so then words in this language would be just sequences of A's, and then it would not matter if I concatenate, for example, 5 A's with 3 A's, so the result would be 8 A's, or if I concatenate 3 A's with 5 A's. Yeah? So, but in general, when we have at least two symbols, the concatenation is not commutative. Another notions that will be useful are some relations we can define on words. And these are these technical notions on what we mean by prefix, suffix, and subword. Informally, prefix of a word is some initial part of the word, some symbols at the beginning. Like here, for example, if I take AB, is a prefix of AB, AAB, because this AB occurs here at the beginning. On the other hand, if I would take, for example, word BA, this is not a prefix of AB, because there is no BA at the beginning of this word. Yeah? Formally, we can define it like this. Yeah? So we say a word X is a prefix of word Y. Exactly in those cases, if there exists some word V, such that we can concatenate X with V and obtain word Y. Yeah, so if we can extend this X, if we can add to the right of it some additional symbols possibly, and we can obtain this way word Y, then we say that X is a prefix of Y. Yeah, so for example, for this AB, I can choose as V, I can choose the sequence AAB. Yeah, so if I concatenate AB with AAB, I would obtain this. So we have, so in particular, epsilon is always prefix of every word, yeah, because to epsilon I can add the whole word, and by this I will obtain this word. So epsilon is a prefix of length 0. I can take prefix of length 1 is just A, prefix of length 2 is AB, prefix of length 3 is ABA, prefix of length 4 is ABAA, prefix of length 5 is ABAAB, is the whole word. Yeah, again, whole word is, for any word we have that the word is prefix of itself as a special case, yeah, because I can choose I can choose empty word. And suffix is something very different, but something very similar. The only difference is that prefix is at the beginning of a word and suffix is at the end of a word. Yeah? So formally we say that X is a suffix of Y if there is a word U, such that if I concatenate U with X, I obtain Y. Yeah? So again, epsilon is suffix of every word, suffix of length 0, suffix of length 1 is B, AB is a suffix of length 2, AAB, BAAB, and again, every word is a suffix of itself, yeah? So the whole word is a suffix of itself as a special case. And finally, subword is some sequence of symbols that occur somewhere inside a given word. So formally we say X is a subword of Y if there are some words U and V, such that if we add U to the left of X and V to the right of X, so by this we obtain word Y. Yeah, so examples of subwords of this word are epsilon is again a subword of every word, A. In fact, it occurs several times as a subword. Yeah, here we have three occurrences. One is here, the second is here, and third is here. B occurs two times, one here, once here, and also here. AB occurs two times, once here and here. BA occurs just once here. ABA occurs here as a subword. BAA occurs here. AAB occurs here. So on, yeah. So for example, if I would take BAA, it's a subword because I can choose as U, I can choose A, and as V, I can choose B. Yeah. So A, BAA, B together forms this word. Yeah. Again, the whole word is a subword of itself. Okay, so these were these relations on words, and now we come to the important notion of language. As I have already said, language is some arbitrary subset of words over the given alphabet. Yeah, so in formal language theory, by language we understand any subset of the set of the given words. So it's only important for words whether they belong to the language or not. So here I have three examples. The first one is extremely simple language consisting of just three words over alphabet 0, 1. Second example is the set of all syntactically correct programs in programming language C, which can be viewed as a language over alphabet consisting of all ASCII characters. And the third example deals with searching, where we could consider the set of all sequences of ASCII characters that would contain subword H E L L O, yeah, where this sequence of characters occurs. So this, the set of all such texts that contain this sequence could be considered as an example of a language. Okay, so what we can do with languages? When we describe some languages, it can be sometimes useful to do not describe the given language directly, but rather try to at first describe possibly some simpler languages and then try to construct the more complicated language using some operations that are performed on these simple languages. Yeah, we can use these operations to combine these simple languages into some more complicated language. As we said, languages are sets. So this means that we can perform any operations that we can do on sets, yeah, like union, intersection, complement, difference, and so on. All these things could be done also on languages. So if we have two languages, so the union of two languages is the language containing words that belong to at least one of these languages, yeah, or possibly to both of them. Intersections of the intersection of two languages is the language containing those words that belong to both of them. Complement of a language is the set of words that belong of exactly those words that do not belong over the given alphabet, that do not belong to the given language L1. And difference of languages L1 minus L2 is the language containing exactly those words that belong to L1 but do not belong to L2. Typically, when we will do some operations on languages, we will assume implicitly that both languages use the same alphabet, that they are languages of the same alphabet. This is not very restrictive, because if they would not be the same, we can take the alphabet containing symbols from both alphabets, the union of these two alphabets, and just consider the given language, for example, L1 to be the language over this bigger alphabet. It does not contain any words that would contain the additional symbols from the that occur in the second alphabet. Yeah. So in this sense, we can always assume that both alphabets are the same, because we can take the union of them. Yeah, here described informally, here it's written using mathematical notation. Yeah, so the union of languages L1 and L2 is the set of all words over alphabet sigma that satisfy the property that the given word W belongs to L1 or belongs to L2. Intersection is defined exactly the same, except that instead of or, here we have and. Yeah, so these are words where such that such that they belong to L1 and also to L2. Complement of language L1 is the set of all words over the given alphabet that that do not belong to L1. And difference of these two languages is the set of words that belong to L1 but do not belong to L2. Okay, so these are set operations that can be performed arbitrary sets, but there are other operations that are specific for languages that cannot be done on arbitrary set, but only on languages. Before going to that, I will just give example of these set operations. Yeah, so let's say the first language consists of words that contain subword BAA, and second language L2 consists of exactly those words where the number of occurrences of B's is even. So the union of these two languages is the set of those words that contain BAS as a subword or that contain even number of Bs. Intersection will be the language consisting of those words that at the same time contain subword BAA and where the number of Bs is even. Complement of L1 is the set of exactly those words that do not contain subword BAA. And the difference of these two languages is the set of all words that contain BAA but do not contain even number of Bs, which means that those words that contain BAA and have odd number of Bs. Yeah, so let's go now to operations which are specific for languages only that cannot be done on arbitrary set but only on languages. One of the most important operations of this kind is so-called concatenation of languages. Yeah, so what we mean by concatenation of languages? We have already seen concatenation of words when we just put two words together and obtain this longer word from them by this concatenating. So if we have two languages, L1 and L2, over the same alphabet, so the result of concatenating these two languages is another language, L, which is denoted using dot. So again, this dot is overloaded in the sense that if it's applied to words, it represents concatenation of words, and when it's applied to languages, it represents concatenation of languages. And this resulting language, contains exactly those words that can be obtained in the following way. If there is some word in the first language and some word in the second language, so such that if we concatenate these two words, then we obtain this given word W. Yeah, so let's say if L1 would contain these two words, ABB and word BA, and L2 will contain words A, AB and BBB. So the concatenation of these two languages contains the following words. By taking ABB and A, concatenating them together, we obtain word ABBA. By taking ABB and AB, we obtain this word. By concatenating ABB with BBB, we obtain this word. By concatenating BA with A, we obtain this. By concatenating these two words, we obtain this. And by concatenating this and this, we obtain this. Yeah. We can also say it in a slightly different way. Basically, this means that where it belongs to the concatenation of these two of the given two languages, whether it's possible to divide the given word into two parts, such that the first part belongs to the first language and the second part belongs to the second language. Yeah. So, like here, for example, this word could be divided into part ABB and part BBB, where this first part belongs to the first language and the second part belongs to the second language. And because concatenation of words is associative, it's not so difficult to show that also concatenation of languages is associative. Yeah? So if I concatenate the first language with the second language, and then if we concatenate this result with some third language, we obtain the same language as if we would concatenate the first language with the result of concatenation, the second and the third language. Here is another very important operation we can do on languages, which is called iteration, or sometimes it's also called Kleinistar. Kleinistar, and so it's a kind of unary operation. Yeah, so concatenation of languages is a binary operation because it takes two languages and produces another language. Iteration is a unary operation. It takes one language and produces one language from it. And informally, it can be specified as follows. Iteration of a language, and this iteration is denoted by this star. Yeah, so again, this star is overloaded, is used in several different meanings, such that if star is applied to alphabet, so it represents the set of all words over the given alphabet, but if it's applied to a language, it represents iteration of a language. And iteration of a language consists of exactly those words that can be obtained in the following way. If we can take some arbitrary sequence of words from the original language L and concatenate them together, and by this we obtain word W, so then it belongs to this iteration of a language. yeah, so if the original language L contains these two words, if it's finite, or in this example it's finite language with just two words, we can create by iteration from this infinite language. If I take, for example, sequence AA, B, AA, and concatenate them together, I will obtain this words. Yeah? As you can see, I can use the same word repeatedly in this sequence of words that I concatenate together. Yeah? And I can take arbitrary number of them. And this includes also zero. Yeah? So in particular, epsilon always belongs to the iteration of a language because it's a result of concatenating zero words from the original language L. Yeah, so it's probably quite natural to to consider the result of concatenating zero words to be epsilon, an empty sequence of empty sequence of symbols. So it does not matter whether epsilon belongs to the original language or not. Epsilon always belongs to the iteration. So what is written here? In fact, it's not completely correct in the sense that it's not a formula of predicate logic. Yeah? Because of these dots. Yeah, we say W belongs to the iteration even only if there exists some number, some natural number n that specifies the number of words we will select, and there exists a sequence of words W1, W2 up to Wn where all of them belong to language L, such that by concatenating them we obtain word W. This is not completely formal, yeah, this definition. So if we want to define it more precisely, it can be useful to introduce an auxiliary notion of a power of a language. Yeah. So for example, L22 can be viewed as a second power of L, yeah? So it's the same as L concatenated with L. L23 is L concatenated with L concatenated with L. Yeah, because concatenation of languages is associative, so it does not matter in which way we parenthesize this concatenation. L24 is L concatenated with L concatenated with L concatenated with L, and so on, yeah? And it's again quite natural to take L21 to be just L, and maybe a question is what if it makes sense to define L20, what is zero's power of L, and again, it's probably quite natural to take L20 to be a language. Just know that L23 is concatenation of L with L with L. Yeah? So basically it means that L23 contains exactly those words that are obtained by concatenating exactly three words from language L. Yeah? So we take the first word, second word and the third word and concatenate them together, and by this we obtain word in L23. Yeah? So if L contains these two words, so L23 contains exactly those words that can be obtained by concatenating triples of words from this original language. Yeah? So if I take words AA, 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 or AA, AA, and B and so on. Yeah, so here or combinations I can we can obtain this way from this language. So if we have this intuition, what it means, this power of language. So we can define L to K using an inductive definition, or L to zero could be defined as the result of concatenating zero words. Yeah, so concatenating of zero words is just empty word. So it's a language that contains just empty word and nothing else. Yeah, so this language is not empty. It contains one word, but this word is empty. It contains zero symbols. So instead of writing it like here informally, we can define the same thing by inductive definition. Yeah, we start with the case. We can define L to K by defining what L to zero. It's just language containing empty word, and then as inductive step to define an L to K for if K is greater or equal to one, could be defined as L to K minus one concatenated with L. Yeah, so you can check that if I take for example L to zero and concatenate with L, so this language containing just epsilon concatenating with any language is the result is the language itself. Yeah, so L to one is L, and if I know that L to one is L and concatenated with L, so the result is L concatenated with L. If L to three is L to two, which is L concatenated with L. L to two concatenated with this is L to two. Result of L to two is this. Concatenated with L is this, and so on. Yeah. So now we have defined this power of language, power of a language, and now we can define the iteration of a language as an infinite union when we take this big union over. For all values of k greater or equal to zero of these languages L to K. Yeah? So this is notation denoting this infinite union, containing L to zero, union with L to one, united with L to two, united with L to three, and so on. Yeah, L to four, L to five, and so on. In other words. A word belongs to this set if it belongs to at least one of these powers. Yeah, so this probably this notation with start, it can be intuitively understand as this star stands for arbitrary number. Yeah, so if L to three are those words that are obtained by concatenating three words from L, so L to star is concatenating arbitrary number of words from L. Sometimes it's also useful to use this plus, this upper index plus, which denotes something similar, but as iteration, but here iteration includes also L to zero, yeah. So the number of words could be zero. This L plus means concatenations of arbitrary numbers of words from L, or language consisting of those words that are obtained by concatenating arbitrary number of words from L, but non-zero number of words. Yeah. So there must be at least one word. So note that these two definitions are very, very similar. The only difference is that here we take k greater or equal to 1, while here we take greater or equal to 0. So here it would mean that this in L plus, this part would be missing, and all this remaining part would be the same. Yeah. It can be also alternatively, it can be defined as this as a shorthand for L concatenating with L star. So these were very important operations that we can do on languages, were the set operations, concatenation of languages, and iteration of languages. Yeah? So these operations are very, very important. There are also some other operations, but they are less important. And one of such less important kind of operation is operation of reverse, and I define at first reverse of a word and then reverse of a language. So what we mean by reverse of a word? Yeah, it's a unary operation of a word that just takes the given word and reverses the order of symbols in the given word. Yeah, so reverse of word H E L L O is the sequence O L L E H. Yeah, so like if we would read from right to left. And this operation is denoted by this upper index R. Yeah, this R means this reverse. Yeah, so in general, if word W consists of symbols A1, A2, and so on up to AN, so the reverse of this word W is AN, AN minus 1, and then minus 2, and so on up to A1. So this is reverse of the word. We just reverse the order of symbols in the given word. And now, reverse of language is language consisting of those words that are obtained as by reversing words in the original language L. Yeah, so again, this notation for reverse is overloaded. If it's applied on word, it means reverse of a word, and if it's applied on a language, it means reverse of a language. Yeah, so the reverse is of a language is the set of all reverses of all words that belong to language L. So if L contains these three words, so reverse of this language contains from AB we obtain BA, from this word we obtain this word, from this word we obtain this word. So this was this operation of reverse. And another technical notion that we will need is a definition of a particular order or ordering on the set of words. Yeah? In fact, there can be defined many reasonable ways how words could be ordered, but we will use one particular way, which assumes that we have some particular order on the set of symbols of the given alphabet. Yeah? So if alphabet contains, for example, symbols A, B, C, so we can say that A is smaller than B and B is smaller than C. And we assume that this is a linear order, yeah? Which means that every two symbols are comparable, that always either two symbols are the same or one of them is smaller than the other, that there are no incomparable symbols in this ordering. Yeah, so let's assume we have some fixed ordering on symbols of the alphabet, like ordering ABC. And now we define an order on the set of all words, yeah, so over the given alphabet, and we will denote it by this, yeah, this symbol less than with this index L. And we define when word X is smaller than word Y in the following way. As a primary criterion, we will use the length of the word. So words that are shorter will be always smaller than longer words. Yeah? So if I have one word that has three symbols and another word that has five symbols, so these shorter words will always be smaller in this ordering than the longer words. It does not matter what are these symbols in these words. And in case when the length of words is the same, we will use so-called lexicographic ordering, which is something you probably know from dictionaries. When we order words in dictionaries, we have at first all words starting with A, then words starting with B, starting with C, and so on. And between these words that start with A are the first those that have the we order them according to the second letter. Yeah? And if the second letter is also the same, that they are ordered according to the third letter. If the third letter is the same, then we order them according to the fourth letter, and so on. Yeah. So if I have some word X and word Y, So they have some common prefix U. Yeah? So U is some sequence of symbols. And then there is the first position from the left where the words differ. Let's say in X we have some symbol A, and in Y we have symbol B. Yeah? And the prefixes are the same, and this is the first difference. And there is some remaining part V and here remaining part W, which could be arbitrary. Again, it could be some arbitrary rest of the word. And let's say that according to this ordering on the alphabet, let's say A is smaller than B. Yeah? So then we say that this word X is smaller than this word Y. Yeah, so we order words according to the length, and if they are of the same length, we order them lexicographically. And this ordering has the advantage that it's possible to create a sequence that create an infinite sequence that has a beginning, it has some starting word, and this infinite sequence contains each word exactly once. Yeah? So there is at the beginning there is the empty word, which is the smallest word. Then for all words of length 1, then all words of length 2, all words of length 3, and so on. And because the alphabet is finite, yeah, so we always have just finite numbers of words of the given length. Yeah? So for example, for length 5, we have only some finite number of words of length 5. So these are ordered lexicographically. So we can construct such infinite sequence that has this beginning, where each word over the given alphabet occurs exactly once. Yeah, so it makes sense that to say that this is the first word, second word, third word, and so on. Yeah, in this sequence. And in fact, it would not be difficult to write, for example, some algorithm that would run infinitely, but that could produce these elements of this sequence, yeah, one by one, write them, for example, list all these words, produce them in brute force way. And when we would have some particular language, yeah, so language would be a subset. So let's say, for example, this word would not belong to this language, this would not belong to this language, this would not belong to the language, and this would belong, and this would not, and this would, and so on, yeah? So, then it makes sense to say that according to this given ordering, we can have, for example, the fifth word in a given language, or assuming that we have at least five words in the given language, we can say, let's take first five words of the given language. Yeah? So sometimes we will use something like this in exercises. this particular kind of ordering. So this is what we mean by saying the first 10 numbers of ten words in a given language. Okay, so this was this general introduction about some basic notions and basic kinds of operations on languages, words and languages, and some relations on words and languages. And now we come to different kinds of formalisms that can be used for description of languages. And we start with so-called regular expressions in this lecture. On the following lectures, we will then discuss automata, grammars, and so on. Yeah? So today we finish with description of these regular expressions. Idea is of regular expression expressions is to have some kind of succinct notation that describes languages which are created from some simpler languages by some kinds of operations. Yeah? So how to write these resulting languages in some succinct way and precisely defined way. Like in arithmetic, we could describe numbers by writing some arithmetic expression containing some arithmetic operations like par, plus, times, and so on, which are applied to some numbers, and from them we can produce some result that would be a number. In regular expressions, it's quite similar, but now instead of numbers, we will have languages. Yes, so to define precisely the definition of regular expressions, or the most basic kind of regular expressions we will consider here, we will use, or the notion of regular expression is defined inductively, using an inductive definition. We start with a base that defines some basic kinds of languages, which are extremely simple, and then we will describe as an inductive step the way how from these some already constructed regular expressions we can construct more complicated regular expressions, describing some more complicated languages. So the base of the definition is the following. Yeah? So the symbol of empty set, yeah? So this crossed zero, is a well-formed regular expression denoting the empty language, the language that does not contain any words. Epsilon, yeah? So here not in a meaning of empty word, but epsilon as a symbol, as a Greek letter epsilon, is a well-formed regular expression that denotes language that contains empty word as its only word. Yeah. And if we assume that we have some particular alphabet sigma, and we take some letter from or symbol from this alphabet, some symbol A, so by writing this symbol A, we denote this is a well-formed regular expression that denotes language containing a word with single letter A. Yeah? So if you would write B, so this would represent language containing just word B. So these are this is the base case. These are the base cases. And now we have inductive step, yes? So this alpha and beta are not regular expressions themselves, they are variables whose values are sequences of symbols which are well-formed regular expressions. And assuming that alpha and beta are already constructed regular expressions, we can construct these three kinds of regular expressions. The first one is we write plus between this alpha and beta and then close in the whole expression in parentheses. The second one is to write dot and enclose the expression in parentheses, and the third one is to write star and enclose in parentheses, where this plus denotes the union of these two languages described by this regular expression alpha and beta. Dot represents the concatenation of languages described by alpha and beta, and star represents the iteration of language represented by alpha. And there are no other regular expressions except those defined by these cases. Yeah, so this is the extremely restricted definition of regular expression. In fact, maybe somebody of you may know some syntax for a regular expression which is used in practice, for example for searching in text, or which is available in libraries in many programming languages. And this syntax of regular expressions that are used in practice is more complicated and is much richer than this, but we will concentrate on this restricting mathematical kind of definition of regular expressions. Yeah, and also this particular notation which is used in practice is slightly different, but we will use this notation here which is more common in mathematical books. Yeah, so. And in fact, what is used in practice, most of these extensions are in fact just some succinct ways how to write something that could be already expressed using these definitions we use here. Yeah, so we will use this mathematical definition of regular expressions. Yeah, so to just to give you example, let's assume we would have alphabet containing 0 and 1, and according to this definition, 0 and 1 are regular expressions. Yeah, because of this case. Yeah, because 0 and 1 are symbols of the alphabet, so 0 and 1 are regular expressions. This regular expression describes language containing just word 0, and this describes language containing just word 1. And if we know that these two are well-formed regular expressions, so according to this point, we can create this as a well-formed regular expression. Yeah, the left parenthesis 0 plus 1 right parenthesis is also a regular expression. And because 0 is a well-formed regular expression, then also this is a well-formed regular expression because of this. Yeah, this case. So we can, this is another possibility how to create well-formed regular expression. And by the way, this 0 plus 1, yeah, so as I said before, plus represents the union. This is the union of these languages represented by these two regular expressions. So union is a language containing two words, word 0 and word 1. And this represents iteration of language represented by 0. Yeah, so it's a language containing just one word with one symbol 0. An iteration of this language is the language containing those words that are obtained by concatenating arbitrary number of these words. Yeah? So if we take arbitrary number of zeros and concatenate them together, so we obtain a sequence of zeros. And this also includes the possibility that we take zero words. If we take no words, so the concatenation is epsilon. Yeah, so this zero star is a regular expression that represents language containing words epsilon, zero, two zeros, three zeros, four zeros, five zeros, and so on. Yeah, 1 million of zeros. And we can take the concatenation of these two languages represented by these two expressions. Yeah, so according to this point. So the concatenation would be those words that start with the word belonging to language described by this, which is followed by word subword belonging to this language. Yeah, so we must distinguish the regular expression itself, which here is this particular sequence left parenthesis 0 plus 1 right parenthesis dot left parenthesis 0 star right parenthesis. So this is a regular expression alpha. And the language represented by this regular expression is denoted by L alpha. Yeah? So language represented by this regular expression is a language of those words that start with 0 or 1, which is followed with arbitrary number of zeros. Yeah, so if I concatenate 0 or 1 with epsilon, I will obtain 0 or 1. If I concatenate 0 or 1 with 1 0, I will obtain 0 0 or 1 0. If I would concatenate 0 or 1 with 3 zeros, it would be with 2 zeros, it would be 3 zeros or 1 0 0 and so on. Yeah, So now this finite expression represents an infinite language containing all these words that have the property that they start with 0 or 1, which is followed with arbitrary number of zeros, which includes the possibility that this sequence of zeros could be empty. Okay. As in case of formulas of logic, also in the case of regular expressions, it can be useful to imagine that the expression is represented in a form of abstract syntax tree that captures the structure of the expression. Yeah, the trees corresponds to the way how the expression was created according to the inductive definition. Yeah, so for example, we could take this 0 and 1 and put dot between them. Yeah, so this sub-expression corresponds to this sub-tree, then we apply star on it, so this part corresponds to this one, this one corresponds to this, and it's we use then dot, apply to this and this sub-expression and obtain this. Yeah, so this sub-expression correspond to this, these two ones correspond this one, so this is this sub-tree, these two sub-trees, so these two sub-expressions are put together and they correspond to this sub-tree, this 0 0 correspond to this one correspond to this, there is a plus between them, and the plus is applied on these two sub-expression, and then we apply star on this sub-expression, and then we use plus to put together this expression and this expression. Yeah, so all this corresponds to this. So the leaves of the tree correspond to these elementary cases here. Yes, to these cases, and plus corresponds to a subtree that where the root of the subtree contains plus, and two subtrees alpha corresponding to expressions alpha and beta. Similarly for the dot, it has two subtrees, and star has just one subtree. And in this definition, it was necessary, according to this formal definition, it was necessary to write parentheses always. Yeah? So the structure of the expression, the way how it was constructed, was defined precisely. and it directly corresponds to the way how the tree was constructed. Yeah? And when we have now defined the syntax of regular expressions, we can now define the corresponding semantics, which in case of regular expression, this semantics means what kind of what language corresponds to each expression. Yeah, so again, this definition is inductive. The base case is that for the symbol of the empty set, it represents the empty language. Yeah? Note that the difference between the symbol, the use of the symbol on the left hand side and on the right hand side here. Yeah, so here it represents the symbol of empty set. Yes, but here it represents empty set itself. Yeah? Similarly here, this epsilon here is used as a symbol epsilon, as a Greek letter epsilon. On the other hand, here epsilon means denotes the empty word. Yeah? So for epsilon represents the language that contains just empty word. For symbol A from the alphabet, it's the language containing just one word with one letter consisting of this particular symbol. If alpha is a form expression, so alpha star means iteration of the language represented by alpha. Dot means expression with dot means that it's a language which is obtained as a concatenation of language represented by alpha and language represented by beta. Yeah, so again here this star, dot and plus here are symbols, star, symbol, dot, symbol, plus, and on the other hand here they represent the operations. Yeah, this is the iteration of a language, here it represents concatenation of a language, here it represents the union of the language. Yeah, so plus represents union of languages represented by alpha and beta. And in the original definition, we must always use this parentheses, but it's not very convenient when we write it on paper or on whiteboard or somewhere. So as in case of formulas of logic, we will use several conventions for omitting parentheses regular expressions, and the conventions are following. We can always omit the outermost pair of parentheses, yeah, this outward pair of parentheses, because union and concatenation are associative. We can omit those parentheses that can be omitted due to associativity of union and concatenation, and we specify a priority of operation. Yeah? So the star will have the highest priority, concatenation the second highest priority, and plus will be of the lowest priority. Yeah? So for example, if we take a look at the abstract syntax tree. So, for example, priority of dot is higher than priority of plus, so it's not necessary to have parentheses around this sub-expression. Yeah. On the other hand, it's not possible to omit parentheses around this sub-expression because plus has higher priority than star. And because of associativity of concatenation, it's not necessary to have parentheses that would specify the precise way how these concatenations are performed. Yeah? So, and another convention will be also that we could omit this dot representing concatenation. Yeah? So if this is the original expression, so using all these conventions, we could write the same expression in this shorter way. Yeah? Note that in this shorter representation, there is some ambiguity because it's not specified here how particular the particular way how, for example, these concatenations of these ones, these dots that were omitted, how they are parenthesized. Yeah? But there are many possible ways, but we can understand it that the result does not depend on any particular way. So it's not important. We can choose any of them. And this cannot, for example, this parenthesis cannot be omitted because this concatenation has lower priority than star. If we would omit this parenthesis, it would mean that this star would be applied only to this symbol 1 and not to this pair 0, 0, 1. So these are the conventions for omitting parentheses, and I will finish with some examples of regular expressions that represent some languages. So as I already said, 0 represents language containing just only the only word it contains is word 0. And similarly for 1, it represents language with word 1. If we write 0, 1, so it means concatenation, yeah, because implicitly we have here this dot representing concatenation of these two languages. So if I concatenate language containing 0 and language containing 1, so by this concatenating this words, I could only obtain word 0, 1. Yeah? So there is this is a regular expression representing language containing word 0, 1. And if I write 0 plus 1, so it's union of these two languages. So it's a language that contains two words 0 and 1. As another example, as we have already seen, 0 star is the iteration of this language. So it contains words epsilon, 0, 2 zeros, 3 zeros, 4 zeros, and so on. And 0, 1 star is the iteration of this language. Yeah? So language that contains a word 0, 1. So it's those words that are obtained by concatenating arbitrary numbers of zeros and ones. So it's we will contain epsilon 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, 1, and so on, arbitrary number of times. And 0 plus 1 star is now a regular expression which means represents iteration of this language. Yeah, so these are those words that are obtained by concatenating arbitrary number of words from this language, which are words 0 and 1. So these are those words that could be obtained by concatenating arbitrary number of zeros and ones. which basically means that by this way we could obtain arbitrary word over the given alphabet. Yeah, so we see that there is some relationship between the use of this star here for iteration and use to denote for denoting the set of all words over a given alphabet, yeah? Because if we have language representing the given alphabet containing all words with one symbol for each symbol in the given alphabet, and if we take iteration of this language, we obtain a word, obtain a language containing all words over the given alphabet. And now this regular expression represents concatenation of this language, this arbitrary sequence of zeros and ones, with language containing word 00. So these are basically those words that can be divided into initial part that contains some arbitrary number of symbols and which are followed with two zeros. So these are exactly those words that end with two zeros. So this is a representation of language of those words that have the property that they end with two zeros. Or here is a slightly more complicated example. These are those words that start with some sequence of 01, 01, 01, arbitrary number of times, then three ones, and then again some sequence 01, 01, 01. And we could take union of these two languages, yeah? So if we define these two languages by these two regular expressions, so we can write plus between them, and by this we obtain this regular expression that represents the language that contains those words that could end with two zeros or contains a subword 111, which is preceded by sequence of 0101 arbitrary number of times and follow 010101 arbitrary number of times. And if we would like to express things like those words that contains at least one occurrence of symbol one, yeah, so it can be written like this. It's a concatenation of some arbitrary sequence of zeros and one, followed with one occurrence of one, and followed with arbitrary sequence of zeros and ones. In fact, this is not the only way how this could be done. In fact, almost every language could be written in represented in infinite number of possible regular expressions that denote the given language. Yes, here we could write it, for example, like 0*1. 0+1*, yeah, this remaining part would be the same, that it could be sequence of zeros followed with one, and this sequence of zeros could be empty at the beginning, followed with one, and followed with some arbitrary sequence of zeros and one. And let's end with the most complicated example today. Something like the language containing exactly those words where the number of ones is even. Yeah, such words, they start with some sequence of zeros of arbitrary length, and there will occur occurrences of ones. And we could create pairs of these ones, yeah, the first one and second. That's the one, the third and fourth, fifth and sixth and so on. And for each such pair, we can take the given one, the following zero, yeah, so this is the 0*, then the corresponding one, and then again some sequence of zeros. Yeah? So this is represented by this sub-expression, those words which is one, followed with arbitrary number of zeros, followed with one, followed with arbitrary number of zeros. And we can have arbitrary number of such pairs, yeah? So this is represented that we take iteration of these parts, and all this is preceded by this arbitrary number of zeros. Yeah. Okay, so that's all for today. So thank you for your attention, and thank you. Goodbye.